Hello, and welcome finally to the last topic in this course, which is threads. This is partially a continuation of our discussion of the abstractions provided by an operating system, and it's also a little bit of a sneak peek at what's to come in future courses in the system sequence. So our goal here is to start moving beyond the single-threaded or the uniprogramming that we've been doing so far and start thinking about things happening concurrently or in parallel. And so we want to be able to take advantage of multiple hardware units in order to solve multiple problems simultaneously. So there's hopefully some obvious motivations for this. So we want to be able to maintain utilization of our system. We want to maintain UI responsiveness during computation. We want to be able to respond simultaneously to multiple real-time events. We want to be able to take a large problem and solve subpieces of that problem at the same time in order to solve that problem faster. This is sometimes referred to as strong scaling. We might also want to be able to solve larger problems simply by adding more hardware, and this is sometimes referred to as weak scaling. So we have already introduced the concept of a process, which is an executing program, and so it has code and state. It has the program counter, stack, data, and heap. And every process has its own private address space. So what we're going to be introducing today is the concept of a thread, which is a unit of execution or a logical flow similar to a process. It's an abstraction that's provided by the operating system and runtime libraries. But multiple threads can exist within the context of a single process. So a single process may have multiple running threads simultaneously. And these threads, unlike processes, can share the same address space. So they will have the same code, the same data, the same heap, and potentially the same files. So each thread will keep some private data, so it will have its own program counter keeping track of where it's executing. Every thread will also have its own stack and its own copy of registers. There's a little caveat here in that the stacks are technically also shared, but they're harder to access, and so for the purposes of this course, we're going to consider that every thread has its own stack. So there's going to be one main thread for every process. This is the thread that begins when the process starts executing. And this main thread can create multiple peer threads. And so if we are running on a single core, we'll just switch back and forth between these using a thread context switch, which is lighter weight than a process context switch. So it's cheaper to switch back and forth. And obviously, if we had more than one core, we could be running more than one of these threads at the same time on the different cores. So in the next course, you'll be introduced to Pthreads or POSIX threads. This is a standard interface for creating threads in C. This is not part of the C standard library that we've been working with this semester, and so you have to link against it explicitly when you compile your program. And then you'll call pthread create, and this is the function that's going to spawn a new thread. So it's a little bit like fork, but it's a little bit asymmetric. So this function doesn't return twice. It starts up a new thread that runs a particular work routine. So the details are not super important in this course, but you pass in a reference to a struct where you store information about the thread. You can pass in some attributes. We'll just use null for now. But the important thing is that you actually send a function pointer to this function, and the function pointer is a reference to a function that you've written somewhere that contains the work that you want the new thread to do. And so the main thread is going to return back to this location where you called pthread create, and then the new thread is going to spawn and begin executing that routine that you give it. So that's one significant difference from how processes are forked. There's also a parameter that you can send to this routine, but again, we're not going to make use of that here. You can get your current thread ID using pthread self. You can exit a thread using pthread exit. Although if you are in a work thread, you can also, or a peer thread, you can also end that thread simply by returning from that thread routine. And then finally, there is a pthread join function, which can be used in a thread to wait for another thread to terminate. And this is where you'll need that pthread t struct that we referenced before in order to wait for the proper thread. So here is a brief example. So you can see that we're including pthread.h at the top. Here is our work routine. So this is the function that the peer thread is going to run. So here's our main. So we'll print something out. We'll create one of these pthread t structs to keep track of the child thread information or the peer thread. And then we'll call pthread create. We'll give it a reference to that struct. We'll pass in null for these two attributes. And then we'll pass in a reference to this work function as the thread work routine. And so the thread is then going to be spawned. And so you can see the process here, or the logical flow here, where main is executing, and then we call create, and then the peer thread sort of branches off and begins running work. And then the main thread will run this join command, where it waits for the peer thread to finish its work, and then wraps things up. So here we'll get the spawning single child, and then we'll get the hello from work routine, and then we'll get the done. So some important things to note here are that the main thread and the peer threads have some shared memory. So they do not have completely separate address spaces. So they will share all the global variables. There's a single copy. And if you modify that variable in one thread, that change will be visible to all the threads. And this is often used for communication between the threads. And this requires careful coordination, as we'll see in a moment. There are local automatic variables. So if you have, for instance, a function and you have a local variable inside of that function, every thread that calls that function is going to have its own copy of that function on its own stack. Technically, this is still shared if it's in memory, but it's harder to access because you'd have to have a pointer to a variable that is on another thread stack. So for our purposes, we're going to consider local variables to be private to individual threads. And in particular, it's not really, in particular, if a variable is being cached in a register, then it's not accessible at all, because remember that registers are not shared. So for these reasons, it's safer to assume that they're private, and this is somewhat conventional. Okay, so there are also local static variables, which, like global variables, are shared. So they're very similar to global variables, except they have this reduced scope. And there are heap allocated variables, which basically, if you have a pointer to it, you can access it. And so if multiple threads have a pointer to a heap allocated variable, then multiple threads will have access to that variable. And again, this requires coordination if threads share pointers to the same place in memory.